Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
Thank you, Lord, for a service, a great service, a time of praise and worship today. Thank you, Lord, for the freedom we have in this country to do this without fear of repression or persecution. Thank you, Lord, for the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the praise and the worship, Lord. And as we approach your word this morning, Lord, we ask you to quicken this word to us, make it alive to our hearts, give us a rhema word that will help us in our areas of assignment and influence so that we leave the service stronger than when we came in here today and better equipped to do everything you ask of us in your name in these last days. So, Lord, we thank you in advance for the good that will be accomplished through the preaching of your word here in service today. We thank you for the open eyes and ears and hearts to receive. We thank you, Lord, that we'll leave the service stronger than when we came in here and better equipped to do everything in your name in these last days as you have asked from us in Jesus' name. Everybody that agrees with that said together, amen. Amen. All right, everybody, back up and park. And let's get going. Thank you, Jesus. Before we get into the Word of God, first of all, again, let me just say how much my wife and I appreciate the support that this church offers to us and has done so for so many, many years. This is our home church, although we're not here very much because we travel so much and other things are involved, but we consider this to be our home, and it's always just a joy for us to be here. It's spiritually therapeutic for my wife and I just to be able to come and be a part of what's going on here in this great church. And we want you to know how much we appreciate your prayers and your support. We pray for you overseas, and we believe for God's best in your life. And whether you ever go to the Philippines personally or not, what this church does to help us in prayers and financial support enables us to reach tens of thousands of people over there with the gospel, set people free, people get healed, lives are changed all of the time. We have led to the Lord since we started back in 1980, over 750,000 people to Jesus since we started from then until now. And the church here, we've been in relationship for many, many years, and even if you don't go, your prayers and your support is accredited to your account in heaven someday when you stand before the Lord. Everything you've helped us to do will be accredited to your account. So I want you to know how much we appreciate and value everything you do to help us. None of it is taken for granted, and all of it is very much appreciated. So thank you once again, and thank you for coming today to sit under the ministry of the Holy Spirit. How many have their Bibles or their Bible device? If you have either or, I want you to start with me today by turning to Mark chapter number 9. And we're going to begin reading in the 19th verse. We are going to talk this morning about a challenge that this story we are going to read will illustrate, a challenge for each and every one of us in these last days. All right, and I'll read the story first, and then we'll talk about what that challenge may be. All right, to summarize where we're going to pick up reading in the 19th verse, Jesus has taken three of his disciples and gone off and done things with them and left nine of them in this place. And while he is away, a father brings a demon-possessed son to Jesus for deliverance. Now, he doesn't know Jesus isn't there. So when he gets there, he discovers that the Lord is not around. So he asks the remaining disciples to cast that spirit out. So nine disciples try to cast out that spirit, and they are unable to do so. So when Jesus comes back, there's confusion. There's this discussion going on. Jesus says, what's going on? What's happening here? And so the father approaches Jesus and re-summarizes the whole situation. I was looking for you, but you weren't around. So I asked your disciples to cast that spirit out, and they were not able to do so. So let's keep reading here as we pick up in verse 19. Jesus replies to this. He says in the 19th verse, he answered him and said, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me. So they brought him to him, and when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed, foaming at the mouth. So he asked his father, how long has this been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Verse 23, Jesus replies to that statement. If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Verse 24, listen to the father respond to that. He says, immediately the father of the child cries out and says with tears, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Now, I want you to pay special attention to that last statement from the Father in verse 24. That statement illustrates the daily struggle that people have between faith and fear. And in these last days, you and I are going to need to know how to walk by faith and not by sight more than ever before. And we are going to need to know how to manage fear in these last days more than we've ever had to manage it before because of the hell that's coming our way prior to the return of Jesus. If you think things are bad now, hide and watch for the next 5 years and watch how things continue to get worse and worse and worse all around us in all kinds of ways. And we need to know how to live by faith and manage the fear that comes to us all. And you might be here today dealing with fear, whatever the fears may be. You might be sitting in your seat and you're dealing with fear, fear of the future, fear of sickness, fear of having no money, not enough money to pay bills, fear of what's going to happen to my children if they don't turn around and come back to God, fear of losing my job, fear, fear, and more fear. It comes to us all. But the point is, this guy here, when he cries out, "Lord, I believe, help my unbelief," in a nutshell, the Holy Spirit summarizes the struggle that we have, this dichotomy of spiritual force within people, this decision, this wanting to believe God, but this difficulty of doing so, this constant temptation to fear. "Lord, I believe, help my unbelief." And you may be there today. I've been there many times. And I want you to know that we're going to talk this morning about some ways to combat this and some ways to get over this and get around this, if you will, so that you can live your life the way God intended. Not a prisoner to the prison of fear, but praise God, someone who knows who they are and knows where they're going. How many of you would agree with me that the Holy Spirit knows what He's doing when He inspires people to write these stories in here? The Bible says if we tried to chronicle every story, every miracle that Jesus performed, the books of the world could not contain them all. There are that many of them. So the ones we find in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are handpicked by the Holy Spirit, selected stories for particular reasons. There are reasons why these stories are in here. And I believe one of the reasons this story is in there is for the times in which we live. Fear is driving this planet. And if you don't know Jesus, you are in a world of hurt. You have no reference point for the future. And indeed, as the Bible describes, you are living in perilous times. So we're going to talk about this today. We're going to talk about how to overcome and get to a place where faith rules and reigns and fear does not have that place of authority in our life the way the devil would like for it to. First point, look with me at Luke chapter 8. And verse 50, Luke chapter 8 and the 50th verse with me. This is also going to be a statement that Jesus makes. Luke chapter 8 and verse 50. This is also a story of tragedy where a father comes to Jesus with his to ask him to pray or to come back to pray for his sick girl, 12-year-old girl who's dying. Well, it's too late, and she's dead, and so the people come and inform the father, "Don't trouble Jesus anymore because your daughter has already died." So in response, Luke chapter 8 and verse 50, when Jesus hears this, it says, "He answered the father and says, 'Do not be afraid, only believe, and she will be made well.'" Do not be afraid, only believe. Do not be afraid, only believe. The first point I want you to see from what we're talking about this morning is that you have to make a choice. Choose faith over fear. It's a decision. It's not a feeling. You decide to trust God. You decide not to yield to the fear. You decide that I'm only going to believe. I'm not going to be afraid. I'm not going to let fear run my life. I'm going to believe God. Even if I'm feeling afraid, if I'm feeling the fear, that may be true, but I'm going to rise above my feelings and I'm going to trust God and take Him at His word. Just like what Jesus said to that father here, "Don't be afraid. Only believe, and she will be made well," and she was, because He did, okay? Many, many stories in the Bible that will illustrate this. We don't have time to get into all of these, of course, in one sitting as we are here today, but the one that comes to mind off the cuff is Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, the king who was informed that this huge invading army is coming across the land. They're going to wipe out Israel, and he knows that the size of his army is no match for these invaders that are coming his way. So he calls for a nationwide fast. He gets everybody together. They're crying out. They're standing before the Lord waiting for an answer. And you can just imagine, they know they are toast. If God does not move, they are going to be wiped out.
And so God speaks and he moves upon a particular person and he says, "Hear, O Israel and King Jehoshaphat and all the Jews, I got something to say to you. Don't you worry about this invading army. I got news for you. I got your back. Don't be afraid. Tomorrow go out against them. Get out of here. Go out there and face them. Put the singers in the front, the soldiers in the back, and you go out across the plains. I'll tell you where they are. You go to where they are and you face them. Tomorrow go down and face them and don't be afraid because I will be with you and I will never leave you nor forsake you." And they did, and he did, and the entire invading army was wiped out. They never shot one arrow. They never threw one spear. God set ambushments among the enemy, and they wiped each other out. God's got ways of doing great things when we allow him the opportunity to move, when we choose to trust him and make the decision to have faith and not yield to the temptation to fear. Amen. And that goes for you as well as for me as well as for anybody, because we all face the same stuff. The devil comes knocking on everybody's door. Nobody's exempt from this. All right. So that's number one. Choose faith over fear. Number two, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter number 2 and verse 1. This is Paul talking to the Corinthian church here. And he says in 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 1, "And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." Now, all of that sounds very much like Paul, the great apostle Paul that we know and love and read about and quote and all that stuff, except for verse 3. We love Paul. We love the great apostle Paul, the guy that went out there and introduced the gospel to the Gentile world, spoke to sorcerers and commanded blindness to come down on these people. That guy, the ones that got right in the face of the kings and the Pharisees and told them off, that Paul. Look at verse 3. It says he was with them in weakness, fear, much trembling. He wasn't just barely trembling, he was trembling a lot. The point I want you to see from reading this passage is, don't let fear paralyze your outreach. Get out there in spite of the fear and do something for the Lord. Fear will always be with you. People are afraid of passing out tracts. People are afraid of knocking on doors. People are afraid of sharing Jesus at McDonald's or something because they're afraid of the response. We'll get to that one in a minute. But the point is, don't let fear paralyze what you're trying to do or what God wants you to do in his name. Because it's always there for everybody. Okay? Work through it. Reach out anyway. Paul, in the midst of the fear, the trembling, and the weakness, preached powerful services and changed nations. In the midst of it all, he was not standing up saying, "Hey, check me out, maybe. I am who I am, and you need to know who I am. Dost thou not knowest who I ameth?" The dude was shaking when he's preaching. The dude was in weakness and fear. He had issues just like you, just like me. But he worked through it. He didn't let all of that stop him or paralyze him from reaching out. And listen, when you make the decision to do this, good things happen on the other side of that decision. Things that you will never experience any other way. Are you listening? I mean, I've got testimonies. I've been on boats in the Philippines. You know, the Philippines is islands. You're always on a boat going somewhere, you know, because of what I do. I'm apostolic, so I'm not pastoral. I don't have a church. I got churches. So I'm all over the place. And most of the time, you're on boats to get from island A to island B. Well, these boats, you know, this is not the love boat. We're not talking the Royal Caribbean cruise line here. We're talking about these old beat-up, you know, things over to the side, you know, listing badly to port, you know, built in World War II, you know, that kind of boat. That's what we've been on all these years, little ones, big ones, old ones, rusty ones, you know. And when you get out into the open sea and it's nighttime, see, the boats travel at night. They load and unload cargo during the day when they're in port. And at night, they travel from port A to port B. And so you're out there in the middle of the ocean, and I've been in those storms, you know, doing God's business, and you don't want to go out there because the signal one is up or the signal two is up. That means hurricanes are coming or whatever, and they tell you, you go out there at your own peril. And so, you know, God says, "I told you to go, go." So you're out there in the ship, and once you move out into the open ocean after about 3 or 4 hours, you don't see lights, you don't see shoreline, and if it's stormy, you don't see a moon, stars, nothing. You see pitch black. From about 3 meters out, the lights of the ship is all you've got, and it's black out there. And when the waves get big, and I mean they get big, they start hitting the ship broadside, and that thing starts going over like this, and then it starts going over like this, and people are hanging on, screaming for dear life, throwing up, bottles are rolling all over the place, people are praying. Most of these people are Catholics. I know, I was a Catholic, I know where they're coming from. They whip out those rosary beads. Maybe you know what I'm talking about, but they are seriously praying. These are not just prayers. These are turbo prayers. I mean, these people, they got that beat, and they're just going, you know, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus, holy Mary, Mother of God, prayer, sin, and out the hour of death. And they move right to that next to me. I mean, those beads are smoking. I mean, they know if the old Virgin Mary doesn't show up, we're all going down. You know, there's just fear is just something else over there. I know for which I talk. But if you make the decision to get on out there and get in the game, God will protect you. He will make sure you make it to the finish line. He needs you. Amen. Another example is my wife, Ethel. I never would have met her if I didn't get on an airplane with $20 in my pocket and fly out of LAX with $20 and a one-way ticket to the Philippines and no way back. I met her when I got there. He never told me she's waiting for me on the other side. She had dreams of me when she was a young girl. They were dreams, by the way, not nightmares. And the point is, you know, she's just, what a blessing, what a gift from God. 32 years we've been married, and, you know, two kids and a ministry, and God bless that woman. To live with me, you got to be graced, I got to tell you. But the point is, you know, he knows who we need, but you'll never get to a place where you find the perfect person, find the perfect set of people, find the perfect church until you're willing to engage the enemy and work through the fear while you're doing it. Don't let fear paralyze your outreach, okay? Number three, look at John 14, 27. Let's look at this verse first, and then we'll cover the point. John 14 and 27. This is Jesus once again speaking, 14 and 27. He speaks and says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you." See, first of all, this kind of peace, you can't get this anywhere else except in Jesus. You can't get it through education. You can't get it through money. You can't get it through a job or job promotion or a career, none of that. You get this from Jesus, and there is no other way to get it because it's his peace. All right? But then he says, "Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." Let not, everyone say, let not.
Let not.
That means it's up to us. It's not up to God. That's what the Lord was talking about with that father way back at the beginning when he said, "Lord, I believe, help my unbelief." And the father said, "Lord, if you can do anything, help us." And Jesus said, "What do you mean, if I can?" The problem is not if I can. The problem is if you can. If you believe, I can do whatever your faith enables me to do. It's not up to God. It's up to us. We choose. We make choices. Amen? Thank you, Jesus. And, you know, the devil will just torment you as long as you let him. As long as you give him place, he will torment you until you are a mental basket case. You need to know that. He will never leave you alone until he knows that his tactics are no longer working. And fear is one of his most effective, powerful tactics to use because he knows it's worked before and it's going to work again unless you make adjustments. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. Don't let your heart be troubled. Don't let your heart be troubled. Here's the point. Point number three. Let God's peace replace the fear in your heart. And the fear will try to come, but let God's peace replace it. He said, don't let your heart be troubled. Don't let your heart be afraid. Okay? Lift your hands and begin to praise the Lord. Amen? You want to torment the devil? Lift your hands and begin to praise the Lord. No matter where you are, do it. Well, I don't feel like doing it. We're not talking about what you feel like doing. We're talking about making a decision to do it. Okay? And you'll find the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your heart and guard your mind through Christ Jesus. That peace will guard your heart and guard your mind. Glory to God. Okay, that's number three. Number four, let's go to Matthew chapter 10, verse 24. Matthew chapter 10 and verse 24.
Again, Jesus is the speaker. Here he says in Matthew 10:24, a disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. If it is enough for a disciple that he be like his teacher, and a servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they call those of his own household? Verse 26, notice the first sentence of verse 26. Therefore, do not fear them. All right, how do we manage fear in the last days? Don't be afraid of persecution, because it's coming. It's going to get worse than it is now. If you're persecuted now, okay, good, praise God. Jesus said, if they persecuted me, they'll persecute you. A lot of Christians hide in the corner and hope the devil doesn't notice, because they don't want to get the persecution that comes with reaching out. It comes with the territory. Some people will love us, many people will hate us, but that's just part of it. The Bible says if you put your hand to the plow and look back, you're not fit for the kingdom of God. Nobody enjoys having a door slammed in their face. Nobody enjoys having a tract torn up and people cursing at you and giving you the one finger salute and all those things that people do because they're angry with you because you're trying to save their soul. Well, okay, that's the way it is. Just develop some thick skin and quit letting these people bother you. All right, don't go into, you know, when people, they go out, they're going to go out, pass out tracts, or they're going to go to the airport and try to win souls at the airport terminal or something. The first encounter that's not pleasant, they go into an emotional cocoon for a year, sign up for anger management, therapy, and everything else, you know, because somebody tore up their tract. Let's get beyond all of that. Persecution comes. It comes to every one of us. The more we do, the more we're going to get persecuted. Persecution is always proportionate to your level of outreach. The more you do, the more you're going to get shot at. Amen? Well, they're not all going to line up and buy our CDs when we're done preaching to these people. You know, they're going to be, many of them are going to be quite angry. And some will threaten us with death. You know, my son just got text messages 2 weeks ago. People are threatening him with death in the Philippines. He text messaged me and said, what am I supposed to do? I said, gut up. Man up. What do you think is going to happen? You know, who told you representing Jesus is going to be some cakewalk through life? Who ever told you this? Amen. This is why in the Philippines, my pastors, when they come in for counseling, this only takes once. They never do this again. They come in, you know, and they're complaining about how difficult it is and how they're being maligned and gossiped about and lied about and rumored about and all this. And it's so hard. There's witch doctors and there's demon possessed people and they're all in my service. And I said, what do you want? What do you want from me? Well, you know, I said, listen, nobody told you it's going to be easy. If you want something easy, just die. Go to heaven and it will be easy for you there. And quit sitting on my back. I'm tired of carrying you around complaining all day long. Get out there, put on your helmet, pick up your weapon, and get back out there. Don't come whining to me. Are you listening? Aren't you glad I'm not your pastor? I'd be in jail in a matter of days. I couldn't do it. Anyway, don't be afraid of the persecution that's coming, so relax, let it happen. God's got your back. Don't worry about it when people curse and swear and scream at you. Just let them curse and scream and swear and move on. Amen. God bless you. Be warm, be filled, and be gone. You know what? If you want to go to hell, be my guest, but I'm not going. It's not the standard approach, but praise the Lord, it can be effective from time to time. All right, number five. Look with me at Hebrews chapter number two. Hebrews chapter number two. And this will be talking about Jesus. Here, chapter 2, verse 14. This is talking about Jesus. It says, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Okay, fifth point. Don't be afraid of dying. Don't be afraid of physical death. It's coming to us all. Some of us are farther along the journey than others, but it's coming to each and every one of us. Outside of the rapture of the church, we're all going the way of David, as he said, the way of all the earth. Okay? Don't be afraid of it. The Bible says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of all of his saints. God considers your death day a precious day. For a Christian, we should be looking forward to it. It's the day of transition. We move from this dimension to the real one, to the eternal one, to the unseen one. It's a great day. Ecclesiastes 7 verse 1 says, it actually says, the day of your death is better than the day of your birth. That's what God says. The day of your death is better than the day of your birth, if you're saved. If you're born again, if Jesus is your Lord, look forward to it. We're going home, you know. I got up today, I was praising the Lord, not because I, you know, felt good necessarily, but because I'm one day closer to seeing Jesus. We're all one day closer. Amen. No matter how old or how young we are, we're all one day closer to seeing Jesus. That ought to put a smile on your face. No matter what kind of hell you're going through, we're one day closer to seeing Jesus. Glory to God. Amen. And that's how I do funerals, but which is why no one invites me to funerals. Because I did my mother's funeral in 2003. She left and went to heaven, you know, and so they asked me to do the service. So I did the service. It was in Cleveland, Ohio, where I was born and raised, and she died there. It was the funeral parlor, all that stuff, 9 yards, all that. I'm there, and all the brothers and sisters on the front are weeping and wailing and crying, the aunties, the uncles, the cousins, and nephews, and so. And they asked me to get up and share, and so I did. I said, hey, why are all you people crying? You know, they're all weeping, you know, big tears. Why are you crying? She's in heaven. The body back there in the casket is not our mother. She's in heaven. She's with Jesus. If she had a chance to come back to be with you, she'd say no. She don't want to see you. She's with the Lord. She's running and jumping and dancing and clapping and shouting. So what are you crying about? That's why they never invite me to these things, you know. Bring the organ, bring the casket, but make sure key stays outside. Don't let that guy go in there. We don't want any of that joy stuff. Don't be afraid of dying, praise God. Dying is a part of life. Amen. We're living in a cursed world, my friend. This is a cursed planet. There is no sickness in heaven. There is no sorrow in heaven. There is no tears in heaven. There's nothing but Jesus in heaven. Glory to God. We're on our way. All right. Don't be afraid of physical death. That's number 5. 2 more to go. Quickly. Is this helping anybody? Yeah. All right. Good. Luke 21. Let's go to Luke 21 and look at verse 25. Luke 21 and verse 25. Luke 21 is a chapter devoted to signs of the times. The disciples asked Jesus, what will be the sign of your return? What are we supposed to look for? So Luke 21 is an answer to those questions. Some of the answers are found in Matthew 24, and some of them are found in Luke 21. We don't have time to read all of this, obviously, but beginning here in the 25th verse, Luke 21, 25, it says, there will be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and on earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. How many would agree the earth is definitely in distress? The nations are in perplexity. They don't know how to solve the problems. The problems are too convoluted, too confusing, too complex. They're well-meaning people, but they just can't fix the mess. That's the world in which we live, and it's getting worse. Then verse 26, men's hearts failing them from fear and the expectation of those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Verse 27, then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Verse 28, now when these things begin to happen. How many would agree they have begun? Yes. Oh yeah, we're well into this. We're well into this. They have begun. What's Jesus tell us to do? Look up. Yes. Lift up your heads because your redemption draws near. Here's the point. Don't be afraid of the future. It's good for us. Our future is set. Our future is secure. The world may go to hell in a handbasket. The financial community may collapse again, but God will take care of us. Are you listening? Well, that's kind of a weak response. I mean, listen, God will take care of us no matter what's going on. The promises of God are yes and amen, not maybe. Not I hope so.
not depending upon which political party is in control. God could care less about that stuff. He is in control. His word is final authority. And if you are a child of God, if you are a member of the family of God and the earthbound body of Christ, God is obligated by his word to take care of you. Don't be afraid of the future. Men's hearts will be failing them for fear, but it won't be your heart that's failing you from fear. Don't be afraid of the future. The future for us is bright. He said, lift up your heads and look, be excited for the future. Amen? I'm excited for the future. Yeah, it's perilous, and yeah, there's evil everywhere. Gotcha, I got it. But it won't be for me. It won't be for me. It won't be for you either, praise the Lord, if you just let God be God in your life the way he wants to be. Don't be afraid of the future. Look up. Do not look down. Keep your eyes on the horizon. Jesus is coming, and he's coming for you. All right, number 7, last point. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 13. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 13. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 13, the last two verses of the last chapter of the book of Ecclesiastes. By the way, the same man who wrote Ecclesiastes wrote Proverbs. His name was Solomon, King Solomon. Now, apart from Jesus, what the Bible tells us is that Solomon had more wisdom given from God than anybody else on the planet except Jesus. Okay, he had it. And he wrote Proverbs, and Proverbs is a great book full of all kinds of wonderful things, you know, and we're supposed to read a proverb a day and all that. But then he wrote Ecclesiastes. Proverbs is the great book of wisdom, while Ecclesiastes is the great book of confusion, written by the same man. And there's a reason for that. It's called 900 concubines. That'll mess with anybody's mind. Before he got the concubines involved, the guy had it together. But after all of that, you know, he wrote Ecclesiastes, and you see the difference. Point taken, stay away from the concubines. Just follow Jesus. All right, that's my marital counseling for the day. Take it for what it's worth. Stay away from them concubines. Chapter 12, verse 13, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. So he writes Proverbs, he writes Ecclesiastes, and he sums it all up with these last two statements. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all, for God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. Guess what? God knows what's going on in your life, even if we don't. Even if your spouse doesn't know, God knows. Even if your kids don't know, God knows. And the point is, don't be afraid. The last point for our outline today, don't be afraid of the coming judgment. If you're living your life right, you have nothing to fear for the coming judgment, because there is a judgment coming. See, nobody wants to talk about that stuff because it's not positive. It's threatening. It's not really, it doesn't, you know, these user-friendly, seeker-friendly, demon-friendly churches. You know, these little 20-minute sermonettes where everybody feels better about themselves. They pass out lattes, you know, free, and popcorn, and, you know. But listen, if you want to entertain people, you can fill auditoriums and stadiums full of people. But in this church, we preach the truth. In this church, we let people know because we love people, okay? There is coming a judgment, and you are going to stand there before the Son of God, and he's going to ask you about your life day by day, decision by decision, moment by moment. And your spouse won't be there, your pastor won't be there, your friends won't be there, you will stand alone, I will stand alone, and I don't want to be afraid for that day. How about you? Because if you think our sermons are in your face, wait till you see Jesus. You know, when he was in Jerusalem, he called the Pharisees whited sepulchres full of dead men's bones, and they were sitting on the front row. He said, when you people make one proselyte, you make him a twofold more child of hell than you already are. If I'm the Pharisee, I'm thinking, well, I'm uplifted, I'm blessed. Praise the Lord, I can't wait to get the service ED. How was service today when they get home? You know, how was service today? It's wonderful. The rabbi called me a whited sepulcher full of dead men's bones. I'm so blessed, I'm so edified. I can't wait to come back next week and hear some more. There's coming a day of judgment. Don't be afraid of it. For the sinner, the great white throne judgment, that's a terrifying day beyond words. But for us, we're going to stand before the Lord. And I intend to give a good account for the life I lived. I am not going to stand before the Lord with baggage in my hand that I am ashamed to bring before the Lord. I am going to have a clear conscience. I'm going to preach with passion. Whether you like it or not, I'm going to answer to the Lord. And so will you. So praise the Lord. Don't be afraid of it. It's coming, but look forward to it. I want to meet Jesus. I want him to examine my life because I got nothing to hide. How about you?
The Lord will bring every secret thing into judgment, good or bad. Amen?
All right. So, brings us to the conclusion of the matter. How about the condition of your life today? There's a judgment coming, and it's coming for you. All right? And we laugh and we praise the Lord, and all, but there's coming a day when you will stand before the Lord to answer for the life you've lived and all the decisions you've made. And every human being will do this, will experience this. Okay? And I want your experience with the Lord to be positive, positive, positive. That means we start by making our life right with God. We start by accepting Jesus. We start by turning our life over to him, where he is the Lord of our life. Where we are not the Lord of our life, he is the Lord of our life. We don't make decisions. He makes the decisions for us because he has our best interests at heart. How many believe he knows us better than we know ourselves? And this is how we preach in the Philippines. I just lay it out there to the Filipinos. I say, look, you're going to go to heaven or hell. You're going to die and you're going to go to one or the other. So make up your mind, because in this world, you have the power of choice. But in the next world, you don't. And the choices you make now determine your eternal destiny. You go up or you go down based upon the decisions and the choices you make in this life. The moment a person dies, the power of choice is removed. You can't choose. The choices you make now seal your destiny, which way you go when you die. And if you start to go down, you are going down, and there is no way to stop it. Because you can't stop halfway down and say, oh, I'm sorry, I intended to get saved, but I just was too busy. Or I meant to get saved, and I just had other things to do. It's too late. So, don't let that happen to you. I know there were hands raised today that said, the first-time visitors, we're so glad you're here. This church was built for you. These departments exist for you. But you have to start with a decision. You have to say, you know what? I'm turning my life around. I'm going to join the club. I'm going to get into the family of God. I'm going to get serious about serving Jesus. And if you're here today and you did this at one time and you have drifted away and you know it, and you're just going to church because it's Sunday, and you know, it's Sunday and I'm in church. No. You need to relight the pilot light inside your heart. That living, breathing fire you used to have for Jesus. If it's not there, you need to find it now. Find it today. Amen? All right. Let's all stand. We've been sitting for a little while. I'm going to do something. This is the way I do it overseas. I count to three. And when I reach three people that are not ready for God, I tell them to put their hands up. And I'm going to tell you to do the same. I'm not asking, I'm telling you. Okay? We love you here. We love you enough to tell it to you straight. You need Jesus. And I'm going to count to three. And when I do, you make a decision right where you're standing, right at your seat. You put your hand up and you say, I'm going to turn my life around. I am not going to stand before the Lord and be judged for a life I could have had, I should have had, or I would have had. I'm going to stand before him because of the life I chose to have, because I made the decision to follow Jesus or to come back to him, if that's you I'm talking to. When I reach three, when you hear me say three, you put your hand up. No one's going to be looking at you. Well, what are they going to think? They'll be thinking that you're the smartest person on the planet because you put your hand up. Amen? Praise the Lord. It's not a feeling. It's a choice. Choose Jesus. Choose life. Choose to turn your life around. One, remember, it's not a feeling, it's a choice. Two, three, put that hand up if I'm talking to you. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, many in the back, I can't count them all. Here, over there, hands in the back. God bless you, thank you for being honest. Put that hand up if you need Jesus. You know you need him, put that hand up. Don't be ashamed, don't be afraid, don't be hesitating. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Father. Put that hand up. We want to see. Glory to God. If you got your hand up, I want you to step out from where you're standing right now. Come on down the aisle. Come right down here to the front. Let me congratulate you face to face. Would you come on down here? Come on down here. Come on down here. Come on. Come on. People in the back, come on. Way back there. You guys, come on down here. Come on. Don't be ashamed. We love you. Come on down here. Amen. People in the back, come on. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on. Thank you, Father. Glory to God. Come on. We'll wait for you. Amen. People are still coming. People are still coming. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Proud of you. Proud of you. Thank you, Father. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Come on around, right over here. We're so happy for you. Amen. Glory to God. What a wonderful, wonderful picture. Just like I said a minute ago, everybody, in this line, you have no idea how precious this is. We're going to help you understand how precious this is. But I want you to know all of heaven is jumping for joy right now. All of heaven is rejoicing. Angels are singing. People are clapping in heaven because of you. Because of you. And I want you to know we are very proud of you. And it takes a little bit of gumption and guts to do this. We know that. And you came down here. God bless you for that. We're going to help you. We have a trained pastor right here, Pastor Joel. He's going to take you aside for a few minutes and just pray with you and help you understand the magnitude of the moment. You may not realize this is the best day of the rest of your life. This is the day you turn things around. This is the day all of it was left behind and we turned it around for Jesus. Okay? So listen. If you came with friends or relatives, just let them be patient. This is not going to take long, but they'll wait for you. Trust me, they'll be happy that you're doing this. Just go with Pastor Joel for a minute. Would you follow him? He'll help you. He'll pray with you. Just follow him for a second or two. Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.